Alright, so you guys have asked for a Galaxie suspension video, and that is exactly what I'm doing today. After the break, we're going to be talking about 1960 to 64 Galaxie suspensions, because quite frankly, those cars are the most problematic ones of the cars that Ford built back in the 1960s with the Galaxie frame. There's a lot to unpack here, and that's why I'm breaking it off. If you guys want to see a video on 1965 on up Galaxie suspension modifications, let me know in the comments below. We'll take care of that in the coming weeks. But for right now, I really want to concentrate on what I would consider to be the problem child of Galaxies, and that is the 1960 to 1964 cars. Because those suckers, there's a lot wrong there. And if you got a 63 or 64, you'll really want to pay attention after the break.
Restoration of a classic Ford is a journey of discovery. Let Autocrafters help you with yours. We offer quality parts for Falcon, Fairlane, F-Series, Galaxie, Maverick, and Pinto. Contact us today.
All right, guys, we're going to talk about the ugly first, and the ugly is the 1963 and 64 Galaxie lower control arm eccentric that was used on the front part of the control arms on the 63 and 64 Galaxies. It is an absolute nightmare of design, and I'm not even sure what Ford was thinking. I am sure that in highway running over the open road, this eccentric was great for giving a nice, smooth ride, giving you that plush push down the interstate, but it sucks. There's just no other way to put it. It's terrible. It really creates a lot of problems in the front end of the 63 and 64 Galaxies, because what it does is under hard cornering, it changes your caster and camber to where it is giving you a very bad bump steer signal on the front end of the car. And what that means is the steering will be ratcheted out of your hands. It'll feel really loose and weird. Under hard braking, it does the same thing. It'll tend to dart in one direction or the other because those front sections of the control arms are actually moving out in a different arc from the back. You can't make this stuff up. So what do you do to fix that problem? Now, there are two ways to eliminate this problem. One of them is to do what Ford did back in the day. They just simply eliminated the eccentric on their performance cars, police, and taxis. If you got the 427 side oiler with the two fours or even the single four barrel, Ford did not put the offset eccentric in there. They actually put a straight shaft assembly in that made the car handle a ton better. And you can actually get those. Born Again Classics actually carries a full complete replacement that you can do, or you can send your originals in to those guys and they will rebuild it using that system that they have available. If you send yours in, it's a little bit cheaper. The other ones are more expensive, but it is a completely new unit. You don't have to worry about any kind of problems with rust out or any of that kind of stuff with those two parts. Now, the other thing you can do is to use the Buds Classic Car Tie Rod Stabilizer. Now, this is not to be confused with the tie rods on your steering system. This is a tie rod to go between the two eccentrics and hold them in the same line of motion, effectively stabilizing them. This was something that was done as a Band-Aid fix from Ford back in the day. You will find these on some of the older cars. If there's a bar between those two eccentric mounting points, then you'll know that this car has seen the update to the tie rod stabilizer. It's a nice way to get around it, especially if you already have the front end redone on the car and you don't want to go back in and change out the eccentrics that you've already put money into, if you will. This is a good solution for that, and it'll give you close to what you would get with the original mod Ford put that we were talking about with the replacement of the eccentric. Suspension deflection. What is it? Well, in the Galaxy, the problem that we have is after 1961, Ford went to a much larger rubber bushing on the suspension. When they did that, it created more suspension deflection because the control arms had a much greater range of movement inside those bushings. Now, why did Ford go to a bigger bushing? Why didn't they just stay with a small bushing like the earlier cars? Well, the reason for that is cushy ride. They wanted to give you ride comfort in those cars that you're not going to get in the mid-sized cars like the Fairlanes and the Falcons and the smaller cars like that. So in doing that, they put a bigger bushing on that, but what they did with that also is they actually they kind of degraded the performance aspects of the vehicle. And Ford really wasn't that married into the performance thing other than saying so in the brochures and stuff. You could get a 427 Galaxie in 1963, but you didn't get like super duper high performance suspension stuff like you get with cars now. So that being the case, what do you do to reduce the deflection? Can you put the urethane stuff in there? As far as I can tell, no. I can't find any urethane bushings available for the 62 to 63 Galaxies or even the earlier cars. If you know of a company selling urethane stuff for those cars, please let me know in the comments below. If I see the comment, I'll put the information up into the description so guys can go and attack that from that level if they so choose. But I will warn you, urethane, while very cool for stiffening up that front end, it's going to increase ride harshness. It's also not going to hold up as well as the original rubber bushings that would go in there, and they're going to tend to squeak a little bit unless you can get something that's graphite impregnated. So you're going to need to have all of that going on when you make this modification, if you can find the parts to make the mod. So how do you get better handling and alignment specifications out of your classic Galaxie? Well, one thing I will tell you that you can do is you can contact the guys like at Fat Man Fabricators. They offer upper and lower control arms that give you better camber and better caster than what the original arms are set up to normally run. You might ask me, why is that a problem? Well, back in the day, Ford put manual steering on pretty much everything. Power steering was actually pretty rare, even on the big car Galaxies a lot of times. And what Ford would do is they would put nearly zero caster into the front end of the car, because the more caster you add, the harder the car will be to steer. Couple that with bias ply, skinny tires, and big 15-inch steering wheels, and a manual steer car back then really wasn't all that bad. But it really sucks today. You'll want to have about 3 degrees of caster, and it's going to be hard to get that, as well as get excellent camber change out of the front of the car for handling with the stock stuff. The Fat Man arms will allow for all of that, and it'll put you in a good spot to get better handling out of the car. So sway bars. I found one company that stocks bars for these cars, and that is Quickor Garage. They have front and rear bars. They carry a 1-inch front bar and a 7/8-inch rear bar. So you can get those, put them in the car to help the handling prowess of these vehicles. Because these cars are a leaf sprung rear axle, I really tend to want to put a rear sway bar on them to help them handle out a little bit better. The next thing I'm going to talk about is shocks relating to the sway bars, because you can make up some of your ground for stiffness and handling with your shock absorbers, especially in this day and age where there are so many single and double adjustable shocks available on the market. I still like the idea of a non-gas shock typically on these cars, but they are very expensive. They're not a cheap proposition. Better to probably go with something like the RideTech shocks that I'm showing you right now. Now, these shocks are new on the market for the Galaxies. RideTech also has an air ride system I'll go over in a second here, but these shocks are double adjustable. They are a gas charged shock, but from what I've understood from RideTech, these shocks are not as charged as some others on the market. So we're going to probably get a set of these in and try them out on a vehicle here in our larder at the shop and see what we come up with on the shock side of things. So air ride, what do I think about it? I think air ride is probably a good option for these cars. Because the air ride system can be done anything in any way you want. The guys at Air Ride Technologies actually have a couple cars that they autocross and they road race that have air ride suspensions in them. So that tells me that it can be done and it can be made to work. The nice thing about it is too, the guys at Air Ride Technologies actually have a four-link system that works with their bag setup that they offer for the Galaxies that'll allow you to have a four-link out back and lose the rear leaf springs and get a little bit better rear axle performance out of your 60 to 64 Galaxie. So I think air ride is probably a cool option on these cars. All right, I'm gonna talk a little bit about lowering if you're not doing air ride, because with air ride, you can put that sucker wherever you want. But if you're gonna lower your vehicle, you need to be aware of some things. Number one is this: if you're doing the rear leaf setup and you're going to lower it, I am not a fan of lowering blocks personally. I don't like them because I think that they change the angle of attack for your rear axle. The rear axle needs to be as close to the leaf springs as possible. If the engineers could have done it, they would have put the rear axle through the middle of the leaf spring. But the further away you get that axle from the leaf spring, the more deflection you're going to get, and it's going to tend to cause the thing to wheel hop a little bit more, which is kind of a problem. So if you're doing a lowering situation in the back, always do it with rear leaf springs. That's going to be your best bet. Don't do the lowering blocks if you can help it. If you want to lower it, you know, like I said, you can buy the back half of the Ride Tech system for Air Ride and just have the back end done that way. Honestly, the Mercury Marauder that Ford released in 2003, I think, that was an Air Ride rear suspension. So we do know that Air Ride can be made to function pretty well. So I would drop the front end with drop spindles. That's just the way I would do it because I think it is a much better way to get your car down to the ride height you want to have and not start incurring any problems with the suspension by cutting coils and all that. I know you can cut coils and I know it works fine, but if I can keep everything the way it needs to be and run a drop spindle that gives me a 2.5-inch drop up front, I'm going to do that instead because all the geometry stays the same and you're just relocating your spindle into a higher point on the spindle, which will lower the car. And when you're lowering the car, what you're really doing is you're getting a lower center of gravity in the vehicle. When you have a high center of gravity, the car tends to want to heel up and over. The lower the center of the gravity is, or the closer it is to the road, it will tend to not heel as badly. And it also supposedly helps with wind and all that, but it's a Galaxie. I mean, let's face it, the car is big. It's not going to cheat the wind. It's going to beat it into submission. It's just the nature of the way things are. Brakes. What am I going to do? Well, what we're going to do on our 63 Galaxy is we're going to be using brakes from the guys at Autocrafters. They have a really nice kit available. We may even go with power disc brakes on that car. I'm not real sure. But whatever the case may be, we are going to be upgrading to disc brakes and also upgrading to a dual reservoir master cylinder. That is probably the biggest change you need to make on the brake system. If you don't do anything else to your Galaxy, put a dual reservoir master cylinder on there. The fruit bowl master cylinder is really cute. It does look like a fruit bowl, and it is almost completely useless. But now there's other things you can do for brakes. You can do Gran Torino brakes. The 1972 on up Gran Torino brakes will work. You can use the LTD2, which is the bigger LTD, well, the small LTD. It's so confusing because I use that name in like 500 different places. But you can use the LTD2 brakes. You can also use the brakes from a Cougar from that era when they went to the full frame car, or the 77 on up Thunderbird brakes. Those will work as well. We have this information in the description below because it is kind of convoluted. But you can also do this. And I don't even know why I'm bringing this up because it is so convoluted. I'm not even sure I understand it. You can use the spindle from the 72 to 77 Gran Torinos with the disc brake rotor from a 1972 Thunderbird combined with the original calipers, and that gives you an 11.72-inch rotor, which is a little bigger than the 11-inch rotor that those cars actually came with on the Torino side. I am really still not sure how that thing works out, but there are guys that say that is a thing to do. Personally, I'm just going to go and jab the money at the guys at Autocrafters and get a set of brakes, or if I go with Fat Man Fabricator drop spindles, I'm going to get some Wilwoods in whatever stinking size I want, because that's, you know, what you're going to do. So you say, Jeff, what about chassis? What about chassis indeed? To me, I don't know. I mean, it depends on what kind of car you're building. If you're building a street driver car, you're probably not going to do a chassis, and I'll tell you why. Because it's kind of like taking an airplane, dead stick landing it, and the gear won't go down. When you hit, it's going to hurt. They're really expensive. I'm not dissing the chassis. What I'm saying is you start breaking past a street driver car when you're dealing with chassis. Most of these things are running $12,000 and more. But the nice thing about that is that you can set it up with whatever transmission you want to put in it. You can set the chassis up to run the Coyote engine if you want to put one of those in there. They can do anything you need to do. If you want to put an LS in your Galaxy, they can set the frame mounts up for that to work. So it is an option. I just don't know whether most guys are going to want to put the kind of money in the chassis that's going to be required and not get that money back out at the other end of the build. Of course, if you're building a car to get money out of it, you're probably not building it for the right reasons. Sorry, that's just how I feel about it. So I'm going to talk about frame swaps now. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, frame swaps ain't going to happen. Not without a gas axe, a bunch of baling wire, and a bucket full of cash. Might even need a wheelbarrow. Because none of the frames after 1964 are the same as that frame. Here's a photograph I'm going to show you of a 63 Ford Galaxie frame. This is a 65 on Up Galaxie frame. And this is the Crown Vic frame. It can be done, I am sure. I'm sure there is a way to make this happen. It's just not an easy fix. There are things that you're going to have to do to make it work. So just know that you're not going to be able to say, well, if the 65 on up frames work better, then I'll just throw that underneath the 63 body. No, you won't. You just won't. It's not going to happen. Sorry. So that's our show for this week, folks. Do me a favor and go out and subscribe to the channel. Hit that bell for notification. If you don't hit the bell, you'll never know we're putting videos up because YouTube just ain't gonna tell you. Also, check out our Patreon account. At the $10 a month level, we have monthly meetings with me on Zoom. Now, these Zoom meetings, I am interacting with you. We are talking back and forth. I am not sitting there just pontificating about things and you having to just sit there and watch me. No, you get to interact with me once a month. We do tech questions. We talk about what the show's going to be doing. It's a lot of fun. Guys really seem to enjoy it. Plus, you're helping us grow the channel when you do that. Also, folks, go out and love on each other, like each other, treat each other nice. You guys have a great week and we'll see you on down the road. These videos are probably the hardest ones I do because on this end, it's not so bad. I'm done in like 30 minutes or an hour, but the post side of it is a problem because there's so much to do. Pictures and video and trying to get rights from people.